them today. Very exciting. But first, I'd like you to ask to stand with me, please, as we say our first song of praise, Majesty.
Sharon is in the hospital right now. Kevin, can you give an update on that?
So this morning I got a call from Sharon at 6:30, needing Robin. She went over. She was in a lot of pain. She was very sick and nauseated. She got to the hospital this morning. Her blood pressure was 202 over 105. They gave her morphine for pain. They thought it was going to be an emergency thing with her gallbladder. But Robin just texted me, and the test came back that that is not the case. So they're still doing tests on her. On Wayne, Wayne's kidney levels are moving in the right direction, and he's hoping to come home tomorrow. But he still has some hurdles himself to go through.
Okay. My back is doing better. I'm not 100%, but I'm getting there. Amber talked to me downstairs. She just wanted everybody to know. She had asked for prayer a while back. She had was getting a job interview at the central office for our County Board of Ed. She had the interview. It was successful, and she's been called back for a second interview. So things are looking up. Just please keep her and that in your prayer so that she makes the right choice. Any other updates?
Christopher Dick is sick.
Okay.
They thought he had strep, but did not.
And his dad is still in the hospital.
John and I went to visit Arla on Friday, and it was a very nice visit. She is upstairs, or she was upstairs instead of in the basement. She climbed the stairs herself. She's doing very well. And she also asked us to put, I believe it was her nephew, L.J. Riggleman, on the prayer list, and I don't remember why.
Did you write the prayer list?
Touché!
Go ahead, Randy. Tim.
A word of praise. I've been praying for my daughter for a job, and Boston and I, we got word yesterday she will start a new
So, but she's very happy about it, and it's going to put a position where she is, if I remember correctly, there's only one person to vote, so she is very happy about this. It's, so, and so it will, so it's an answer to her. Because as of Friday, she didn't have a job anymore.
John?
Prayer praise for our grandson, Michael. He starts a job with AT&T on Monday.
Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing us to come into your house, Mom. Father, we have some sick and those that have passed this week, and we ask that your healing hand be upon those. Thank you for Arla getting much better. Thank you for Amber and the job opportunity she may have. Thank you for Michael and Rebecca for you being with them and both starting new jobs this week or next week. Father, be with us in this worship service, and the words that the pastor has prepared for us to hear be a blessing in your sight. Amen. In the Son's name, amen. Robbie, yes, yeah, come up a second. We'll take it easy on you. It's not going to be that bad. So you guys leave next week, and you're heading to Florida.
Yes,
for a couple weeks. So Robbie, where are you going to be going after your 2 weeks of training?
I'm going to be going to Zambia,
okay.
To drill wells in various villages,
okay.
And also clear out soccer fields for them.
Okay, excellent. Jack?
I'm going to Ecuador.
Tell
them. I'm going to Ecuador, South America, and I'll be building a multi-purpose building for my Bible schools and stuff like that.
And how long have you been going? Have you been
going
8 weeks?
Yeah.
That's and Jack, give you 7 weeks, and then you'll be flying back home. So, anything else you want us to know about your trip? No?
I'll ask Mom how. Yeah. Mom, how she's going to be going.
What organization are you representing? Mom, do you want to share anything?
Well, they're going with the same organization that Barbara and I went and met there.
Yeah, 18 years ago this year.
18 years ago.
Robert was on a mission trip, so was Megan. They actually met during the boot camp, the 2-week training.
Well,
and look out.
Yeah, we went on the same.
Oh, you went out? You're okay.
He went the year before to Australia, and our team was playing there.
Excellent. So last I heard, this was a quite expensive trip. How much did they have to raise each?
Jeff had to raise $3,290. Robbie had to raise $4,590. And Jack was fully funded. Robbie's almost fully funded. There's a little bit left. About $42 left. But we still have a few needs that the low off we can go to. We are responsible for flying them home from Orlando after their trips. And then also runs beside.
So during the, I was going to say right before the collection went out, we are going to be taking a love offering. Kind of the way we do it, we don't pass the plate twice. There's an envelope you. If you want it to go toward Robbie and Jack, just write more missions or anything. We'll get them in. All that money will be given directly to the Moore family later today to help fund their trips. So just during the record collection, more missions, put in an envelope.
Please stand with me again for our next song of praise.
Send the Lord. Send the Lord. Send the Lord. Who bless trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. How you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I'll follow you, yeah. I'll follow you, yeah. Light unto the world, light unto my life. I will live for you alone. Higher than my soul, higher than. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow you. I will follow. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I love. How you serve, I serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you.
Good to see everyone here this morning. Happy to have you here. Thank you, fellas. Appreciate that. That is a big undertaking, going far, far away from home. But God will be with you and will bless your work. Yes.
Hi. Video? Video?
I'm sorry, I jumped the gun. Excited to get started.
What happened that day when the Spirit arrived, when the Holy Spirit came? What happened then? It got loud. Loud enough to be heard all over town. Fire appeared, divided and dispersed to each of them. The outsiders came running. And they heard the fire talkers tell of God's mighty works in their own language. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, Libya, Rome, Jews, proselytes, Cretans, and Arabians. The Spirit had come to describe the glory of God in their native tongues through those who followed Christ. These representatives of the world stood astounded but curious, bewildered but ready. Then Peter showed them from the scripture exactly what it meant, revealing God's promise to all who trust in Jesus. And many believed, and many repented, and many were baptized, and many were saved. the Spirit had come. The church was born.
Now? This morning, Judy is worshiping up in beautiful Half Moon, New York, in Pastor Duke Herbert's church with Mike and the kiddos. It was Mike's birthday this week and or next week, and Judy didn't want him to be alone. Most of you know that Mike is the single father of six foster children. And you know, sometimes it's interesting how the simplest things can mean a lot. He picked her up at the airport. She flew up yesterday morning, picked her up at the airport, and for some reason she started driving, and so they got to a place, they had something to eat, and she says, do you want to drive again? He says, do you mind driving? She says, no, why? He says, it is such a treat to have somebody else drive. He says, I cannot remember the last time that I was able to go somewhere without driving. And again, simple things, but they can have an impact. And so we have to keep that in mind. Tomorrow, Judy and I fly out to the Southern Baptist Convention in Birmingham. And that's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And so keep that in prayer. There are some very big issues that are coming up, and hopefully will be dealt with properly in the convention. And then she and I are going to stay a couple of extra days, take a side trip. And Thursday, we will be in the Dave Ramsey Studios. We're pretty excited about that. So we're going to take a side trip up to Nashville. But we will be back here Sunday for Father's Day. So, but just ask for travel mercies. Today it's 50 days after Easter, Pentecost, the church was born. I was looking, and I've always had a thing about church names. I have had some fascinating, seen some fascinating church names, and I just wanted to share a few of them since we are celebrating, and there we go. The Run for Your Life Chapel, International Chapel. Now, I think Thursdays, I don't know what attendance is like on Thursdays, but if you could see that, on Thursdays is Weak Person's Day. And on Sunday, Normal Church. Holy Ghost Disturbed Church. I don't know if it's the Holy Ghost Disturbed or the church, or what the combination is there. This would crack me up. The Boring United Methodist Church. That church is 30 miles north of here. How many knew that? Boring, Maryland. It's not an incorporated town, but there's a little burg up there by Upper Co. and Reisterstown. Boring United Methodist Church. Now, I don't know if Pastor Dull is the pastor there. But anyways, it could be worse. You could be a boring church. This guy had a big breakfast this morning, and he's struggling to keep his eyes open here. You know, I don't care what the name of your town is. I would call it something else than Little Hope Baptist Church. And this one just, how do I describe this? Hey, Fred, you going fishing? No, I'm going to be at the Church of God. That is the name of a town. And then this one here, Harvey Park Christian Church. I don't know if the pastor's name is Chris, but they're disciples of Chris. And then this one here. We don't know whose church it is, but we know for sure it ain't Peter's church. So there are a lot of churches out there, a lot of forms of worship out there. And the first church, we're going to talk about churches this morning, and if you have your bulletin insert, there's three things, three types of churches that we're going to talk about. And I hope you'll find this uplifting. I hope you'll find this helpful. The church is the only organization that we know that will go to heaven. because the church is the body of believers. This building is the Shechel. This is not a church. This is where we gather for church. The church is the body of believers. And only the body of believers will be in heaven. Governments, as we know them, will not be in heaven. Marriage will be done away with in heaven. And so the only organization that we have in this life, this physical life, that will go to heaven is the body of believers that we have. And that will be in heaven. The first one is the creation of the church. And that is today. So many thousands of years ago, the day of Pentecost. We'll talk more about that. The scripture, you can see it there. This is Acts chapter 2. Hopefully this week you had an opportunity to read that. It's a long passage, and I didn't want to take our time this morning. But you're familiar with the passage. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. Let's pause and ask the Lord to ask his blessing. Lord, we're just thankful for your word. We're thankful for the things we can learn. And we just pray that you help us to read your word and use it to guide our lives and our practices and our conversation. We just pray that you be with us this morning as we study your word, that we'll learn something for our hearts and lives. In your name we ask. Amen. From the beginning of time, from the foundation of the world, God had the church in mind. And he promised that even the gates of hell would not prevail against it. Now that is huge. I'm a believer in Christian schools and Bible colleges and not-for-profit organizations that fulfill the gospel. But the Bible did not say that hell would not prevail against them. Churches close down if the body of believers is not sufficient to maintain the church. Organizations go out of business, but the gates of hell would not prevail against the church. Well, let's turn that around and look at it the other way. You know, one of the, I find the legal profession fascinating, and I have studied the law as an amateur, that is, for my own purposes. But one of the things they teach a lawyer to do is when they first go into law school, they see the law, but they are taught to turn it around and turn it upside down and look at it every different way. If you ever go into court and you have a lawyer representing you, and that lawyer cannot stand on the other side of the aisle, assuming you're on this side of the aisle, if that lawyer cannot stand on the other side of the aisle and argue their case, you're going to lose. You're going to lose money. You're going to lose your case. You might even lose your freedom if it's one of those kind of cases. A good lawyer should be able to stand on either side of the aisle and make a good case. So when I see he promised the gates of hell would not prevail against it, that immediately tells me, that's a warning to me, that the gates of hell will attack our church. It will attack our church family. It will attack our fellowship. It will attack everything good that we're trying to do here. Satan will come against it in one form or another. In fact, if Satan is never giving you a hard time, you must be one of his. Ouch! If Satan is fighting you all the time in everything that you're trying to do, then you must be making a difference. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church, but it's not going to be for want of trying. So Jesus came into the world, and after his death, his burial, and resurrection, his sinless life, the church was formed. And we learned last week and a few weeks before that Jesus said to the disciples as he's going around the earth for 40 days after his resurrection, go to Jerusalem and wait there. Wait there for the gift the Father will send. And today is Pentecost. Cross Sunday. They got that gift. They didn't know what they were going to get. They didn't know how big, how small, how intense it was going to be. Now, sometimes when we think about the starting of the church, we might think of Simon Peter calling the disciples together and saying, okay, so today we're here to talk about starting a church and whether or not we ought to do it. You know, just how are we going to fund this thing? How are we going to do that? Maybe we should rent a storefront, or should we do it in our homes? I mean, this church was formed in a Bible study in one of the local homes until it got too big for the Bible study and a piece of land that was purchased. Many churches start that way. Other times, the Southern Baptist starts hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of churches every year, and they do it through our mission giving, and they find a pastor, they find a spot, and then they fund that organization for about 2 years to get them up and running. It didn't happen that way. The scripture said, suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from where? The east. Came from heaven. God started the church. God created the church. God brought the church into being, and it is His church, not our church. I get so tired of going to pastors' meetings. How many people do you run at your church? It's not my church! It's God's church. And numbers don't matter. Yes, we have numbers in the Bible, but that's not what we're called to do. We're called to reach out and be a body of believers. We're just a part of it. Years ago, when I used to travel the Catskills of New York selling church insurance, I was a steeplechaser. I would drive the back roads looking for a steeple, and when I saw a steeple, that was my target market. And I would go in and I'd find a church, a little church, and met most of the times, and usually there wasn't somebody around, there weren't that many people, so I'd knock on the door, I'd try and open the door, and then I'd start at the houses, and knocking on doors. Hey, I'm here about the church. You know anybody? Usually I found that everybody in the town had a key to the church, but they could let me into the church, and because I told them what I was there for, to save the church some money on insurance and that type of thing. But I heard this over and over again by the person living in the house next door. Yeah, my grandfather started that church. My grandfather donated the land for the church, and he donated the lumber out of his woods. My grandfather started that church. Well, it should be God's church, not your grandfather's church. I did not scold them. That was not my position or my place at that point in time. But I heard that so much, I kind of got used to hearing it. A number of years ago, there were some denominations running ads on the radio and TV, and both sets of commercials were saying almost the same thing. They were advertising for their members to come back to them. You might have heard them. One commercial actually said that the denomination realized they had made a mistake. Here's the quote: "We drifted away from the foundation upon which the church was built, and now we're returning. We're turning back to the Word of God. Please come back home again." That's basically what the commercial said. Now, that's interesting because for many churches, there's a temptation to see what the world is doing and then try and duplicate that to get people to come in. But that's not the way God, I don't believe, has designed it. The bottom line, the church will never be the most popular institution in the world because the church goes counter to popular culture. The church is the opposite of what it's easy to do in the world. We try at the church to encourage each other to be better people, to be kind to people we might not like, to be respectful to people we don't know, to share the gospel with people we've never seen before. That is countercultural. Most times, people hang with people that they're comfortable with that are just like them. See, God wants the church to stand for the truth, to be unshakable in the presentation of the gospel, because the church belongs to God. It is His church, not our church. Now, some say we need a second Pentecost. I have extended family who are in the Pentecostal movement, quite active, and I've heard them say, we need another Pentecost, we need another filling of the Spirit. And usually, being the arbitrary guy that I am, I say, do we need a second virgin birth? Do we need a second Messiah? Do we need a second crucifixion? Do we need a second resurrection? Well, then why in the world would we need a second Pentecost? See, it's our belief that at that time the Holy Spirit was given to them, and there was a sign of that. Scripture leads us to believe that now, when a person receives the Lord as their Savior, they receive the Spirit. But how they yield to that Spirit is how much of an impact the Spirit is going to have in their life. And see, that's uncomfortable. That's uncomfortable because if I am required to be obedient, if I'm required to pray, if I'm required to ask God to fill my life, and I don't have the power of the Holy Spirit, then it's my fault. It's much easier to say, Lord, send down fire from heaven. And give me evidence by speaking tongues. Because then if it doesn't happen, it's His fault. Let's come to the realization. We have all the Holy Spirit we're ever going to need. We just need to be obedient to the Holy Spirit that we have. And that is difficult. It's not easy. I know it's not easy. But that is the reality of where we live. God created the church. He created it for us. All right, second thing is the mission of the church. First we have the creation of the church, now we have the mission of the church. With many other words, the scripture says, He warned them, He pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. This is Peter. Don't call him denying Peter. This is the bold Peter. This is the Peter that lived and remembered his past. This is the Peter that sat down with the Lord three times. He said, Peter, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know that I love you. You know all things. Why do you keep asking me this? He said, feed my sheep. He's feeding them right here in a big time way. Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. We see the mission of the church is to communicate the love of God for a lost and dying world. The theme of Pentecost, believe it or not, is communication. It is really a shame the whole idea of speaking in tongues has become such a controversial issue with men. When you read about Pentecost, the truth comes to the surface. If you read the Bible, the Bible, sure, tamps down a lot of false doctrine. Just read the Bible. The truth that comes to the surface is that God gave the gift of tongues to the apostle for one purpose and one purpose only, the purpose of communication. They had a problem with communication because people had come from many different nations. We saw it on the video clip. When you count up those nations that are listed in verses 9 through 11, you have quite a few of them. But God wanted each one of them to hear the message in their native tongue. Now, there are those individuals that speak several languages, but they have tongue that they're the most comfortable with. And the nuances of those native tongues can give a whole new meaning to something that's said. So God wanted to communicate in their native tongue that they're the most comfortable with. And verse 5 says they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, the crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. The gift of tongues was not an individual uttering speech. The gift of tongues was hearing what was said in your own language. More accurately, we should call the gift of tongues a gift of ears, because people heard. Utterly amazed, verse 7, they asked, "Aren't all those who are speaking Galileans?" I mean, that, in this area, it's like, aren't these people from Glen Burnie? They're not smart enough to know all this stuff, all these languages. How is it that each one of us hears in his own language, our own native language? Verses 9 through 11 list 16 different regions and languages in that section. Now, even if somebody could talk in the language, if you have 16 different languages being spoken at the same time, loudly in the same place, you've got mass confusion. And confusion is not of God. Confusion is of the devil. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our language. The miracle at Pentecost was they heard God's word in their own native tongue. Remember when John the Baptist knew he was going to die, he sent his disciples to Jesus. Are you the one that's coming, or should we look for another? Are you really the Messiah? What did Jesus give as his credentials? Go tell John the poor that the gospel preached to them. See, the miracle of Pentecost is the gospel was preached to all the then known world and people from those regions at the same time. That was the miracle at Pentecost. The gospel was preached to not only the wealthy people, but everyone. Normally the poor people were pushed aside. You don't have enough nice enough suit, you wait outside. You wait outside. You don't have enough money to put in the plate, you wait outside. The first mission of the church is to communicate the message of God's love. Now, if God needs us, if he needs to do a miracle to communicate that, then that's something he can do. But today, maybe we just need to grind it out. Maybe we need to show the love of God by something as simple as digging a well so that they can have fresh water to drink, or building a building that they can meet in for their community activities. We're translating the scripture into different languages. There's an app for your phone that, I heard about this at the Baptist Convention last year. You have the ability on your smartphone right now, if you jump into an Uber and there's somebody who's not a local or from another country, where are you from? Well, I'm from Uganda. Punch in John 3:16, and they can hear John 3:16 in their native tongue. Where are you from? I'm Zoahili. I'm Chinese. They can hear the gospel in their own language. You have the ability to have that at your fingertips on your phone. We're translating scriptures into different languages. There are areas in this world, in the jungles, where they don't have running water, they don't have electricity, but they have a cell phone. Absolutely phenomenal, amazing. We must do whatever we can do, but the mission has never changed from that first day. The moment you become a Christian, the moment I become a Christian, God commissions us, He commands us to share the simple message not only with the entire world, but with our little section of the world. I was able to have a discussion with an individual yesterday for several hours, 3 or 4 hours. It was of the Lord, because normally Judy would be calling, "Where are you? Come home." But she was out of town, and so I went to a meeting and met an individual, and I believe God put me at that place at that time to be a witness to that individual. That individual had never met anyone that could explain some of the things of the gospel to their understanding. Brilliant individual, very smart, but their radar was all in a different direction. God will put you in the position to share your faith if you are willing to do it. Remember hearing about the statistics when Tim Tebow got this crazy idea on his eye black of putting John 3:16? And then there were 93 million hits on Google when they played a big game. 93 million hits for John 3:16. And the quote from Tim just knocked me over. I thought it was hilarious. Here's his quote. Quote, "Honestly, my first thought was, how the heck did 94 million people not know what John 3:16 is? It's like Sunday school, bro. That's the first thing you ever hear." Now, for those of us that were raised in the church, I mean, John 3:16 is Sunday school 101. You and I will probably never have an opportunity like Tim Tebow did. Very simple thing, but God used it. The point is, he heard God's command to tell the world. That was almost like an afterthought, and he did it. You see, when you and I are saved by the blood of Jesus and added to his family, then God expects us to do the best we can to communicate that message to a lost and dying world. That is the mission of the church. Remember when Jesus healed the blind man on the Sabbath? I was sharing with some of you that I was studying, and this kind of thought popped in my head. Oh, Google doesn't answer it over there. But I said, hey Google, what's the scripture reference for the blind man Jesus healed? And it said, John chapter 9, verses 9 minus 12. Instead of 9 through 12. Well, Google reading it with the intelligent 9 minus 12. Anyways, Jesus healed the man. It was the Sabbath. The religious elite went nuts. Oh, this guy doesn't do our traditions. He's a sinner. He's horrible. And so they called this blind man in. Tell us what happened. He told them what happened. They sent him out. And called his parents in. What can you tell us about this? Hey! Now, this is like the CIA or the FBI coming to you in, shining a bright light in your face and start questioning you. They didn't want to get involved in this. They said, hey, he's an adult. Ask him. So they brought him back in again. This man's a sinner. And you tell it, what do you think about it? I don't know if he's a prophet. He said, I don't know if he's a sinner or not. But I do know one thing. I used to be blind, and now I can see. university because that's your testimony. That's my testimony. You may not know all the books of the Bible and how to divide it up and hermeneutics and all of that kind of thing. But one time, I realized I was a sinner. I was blind to spiritual things. And God opened my eyes. Now I can see. He didn't know about Jesus. He didn't know about the detail. He didn't know religious practice. He couldn't quote the Torah. He couldn't explain it. I was blind. Now I can see. That's it. That was his witness. Guess what? That's a huge witness to somebody who is still blind. If I was blind to spiritual, if I tell you I was blind to spiritual things, and now I can see and understand spiritual things, and I'm talking to a person who's blind to spiritual things, do you think that might be interesting to them? Depends on where they are in their life, and why God brought the two of you together at that point in time. The church's mission, your mission, my mission, is to say, once I was blind, and now I can see. All right, finally, the goal of the church. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, we do that a lot, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. So the third goal is to establish a fellowship that's unique. Now, some take unique to mean odd. We don't want to venture off into that, although we are odd to some people. But the idea of the true church is it offers a universal community that unites God's family and directs them toward the transcendent good, the true, the beautiful. Now, in the United States, marriages are being delayed. Fewer American adults are married than in the past. And more are totally unpartnered. Birth rates are down. I read this. It was shocking to me, but it makes sense. In China and India, 70 million men are unmarried because there are no women their age to marry. Why? Because in India and Pakistan, 70 million baby girls were terminated, were aborted for being female. Because in China, where they say you can have one child, well, they want that child to be a boy to carry on the family name and to earn money for the family. So they terminate the girls. Some speculate today the reason there are so many women and girls being kidnapped is to sex traffic them overseas, because so many girls have been aborted. Unintended consequences. Formal religious belief and church attendance are down, especially among the young. People are free from each other and commitments. They release themselves from the bonds of their family and their creeds that they were raised with, if any. But they're finding themselves to be increasingly lonely and unloved. Alcoholism, drug use is at an all-time high. And a lot of the drugs that are going down are not because people are hurting physically, because they're hurting emotionally. And they use that to cover up. The decline of marriage and family drains social capital and renders people more dependent on the government, and it becomes a self-fulfilling cycle. Welfare services, financial security, they have to rely on the government to do that because they don't have family or friends to turn to. And if they've not gone, if they're not going to church, call me hard-hearted, but when someone calls on the phone and says, well, I could really use some financial help. I mean, what did your church say? You go to church, right? That's family, friends, church. That's why we're supposed to be here. to say this other than just to say it. The government has a safety net, and that's a good thing. But what the bad thing is, for too many, that safety net has become a hammock. And they're just resting there. I've tried to hire somebody to do a job, whether it be to paint something or to fix something or clear up. Well, it's got to be off the books because I don't want to lose my government check. Really? You mean if you got a job where you could work for a living, you'd rather, you don't want to do that? I'll work on the side. And, oh, I see, you take your government check. The church provides a way to extend love, unity, and the sacrifice that many times our family would provide if they were there. But many have dysfunctional families. The church can be your functional family if your family out there is dysfunctional. If you don't have any family out there, the church can be your family. They say that the one thing about home, talking about family, is you're just always welcome there. Now, I know that that's not always the case, but in the idea of being able to go home, you're always welcome there. You don't have to have an appointment. Can't you see the early Christians? Now, again, these Jews are displaced, coming from all over for one reason or another. They were displaced and dispersed into different parts of. They're coming back to Jerusalem to worship, as their tradition is, and now they're finding a fellowship, a new fellowship of believers. On the day of Pentecost, there were 3,000 new converts. And suddenly they had something to share they never had to share before. They know that they're guilty, that their sins crucified Christ, but now they've repented. They have repentance. They've been baptized. They've been redeemed. They've been given the gift of the Holy Spirit. And suddenly they're part of a new society. Now, LBJ's new society. A new society. They've come out of a world. They've escaped a world of slavery and superstition. They've come out of a world of greed and dishonesty. There are those that are touting the word social justice, even in our own convention. Well, if you look at the root of social justice, you will find greed and envy. And I would think, isn't there a Bible verse something about how we're to avoid greed and envy? Because that's not a good thing for a Christian to have in their life. These new believers are part of a new fellowship where they can share things about themselves with others who will know and listen and understand and be kind and compassionate toward them. Suddenly a whole new atmosphere prevailed because there were 3,000 changed people that God made different and knew they were born again. No wonder their numbers quickly grew to 5,000, and then the churches started spreading all over the then known world. The church must always be that. A place of refuge, a place of hope. Now, I know that there are those that say the church only wants my money. I get it. I love Home Depot. Mm-hmm. I go there several times a week. They smile every time I walk in and ask me how I'm doing. But before I get out the door with what I want, guess what? They want my money. I've seen some people that try and go past, and what happens? They have big, burly guys that chase you down and take it back. Home Depot wants my money. I go there. We live across from the Golden Corral on Ordnance Road, and I drive by that sign 3, 4, 5 times a day. They have a sign that says, "We have bacon and know how to use it." I like bacon. And I look at that sign. But I know that if I walk through their door before I get to smell the bacon or see the bacon or taste the bacon. There's a cash register. They want my money. They don't care whether I like bacon or not. They want my money. But I go there. Well, I don't go there anymore. My wife will love me. So I go to more home people around. You understand the point. There are those in this world that will take advantage of you. But the church is where you can come and hear the truth. You can be ministered to and needs met in your life. And if you want to sit on your wallet, then sit on your wallet. But a person who is truly born again and truly loves God, they will want to share their time, their treasure, and their talents with the body of believers. Finally, we're to be a different people, a different culture here in these walls. An oasis in the midst of a desert, shade tree on a cool summer day, a cup of cool water when you're thirsty, a place to come and know that you won't be rejected, a place where you will be accepted and loved by brothers and sisters in the family of God. The world changed after Pentecost because of the church's influence on the world. We're going to have a song of invitation in just a minute. If you need to reestablish your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, if you haven't been doing what you need to do in church, if you need to step up, this is the time to make it do it. Let's all stand together. We're going to pray. Praise team, come. Lord, we're thankful for the clear teaching of your word. We just pray that we will accept it. Help us to realize that when we miss the assembly, there are people that miss us, that we have something to give. Be with us now in the remainder of the service. In your name we ask. Amen. Let's remain standing.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity in our worship service to show our love to you by giving back to you. We thank you, Lord, for providing for our needs each and every day. And so we thank you for this opportunity to give back, to meet the needs of those people around us. And we also, Father, would ask you to lay upon our hearts to help out two very special young men this morning to give an offering to help out Bobby and Jack Moore. As they are going to be doing life work, missionary work, just pray, Lord, that you will be with them and guide them in all that they strive to do, be closer to you. Yes, it's all in your Son's name, I pray.
Yes, and Pastor reminded me in his sermon that in July, our business meeting, we will be electing new officers for the church. And it'll be a time where people can share their talents by volunteering for the openings that are available. I'll be emailing a listing of those that we'll be voting on.
Lord, we pray that you bring us back together at the next appointment.